Many websites allow for some amount of user interaction, entering a username and password, for example, or ordering food, or shipping purchased products. An interactive element is referred to as a form control, or just a control. A control can be a text box, checkbox, drop-down, button, or any other user entry mechanism. Many of the form controls are defined using the input element, so let's focus on that element first. The input element is an empty element, meaning it has no content. It tells the browser, "Hey browser, get user input." We use the type attribute to tell the browser what type of control we want it to display. An input element can be a text box for user entry of any text. It can be an email address. Though this looks like a normal text box on the computer, on a phone it will display a keyboard layout that helps with entry of an email address. Plus, by specifying the type as email, the browser will validate the field, ensuring that the user enters text that is an email address. We can use input for a date picker that drops down a calendar, or a number displaying a spinner. But only use a spinner for numbers that make sense as numbers. Don't use it for an employee ID or social security number, for example. We can define a set of input elements as radio buttons, allowing the user to select one from a set of choices. We use the name attribute to group the radio buttons as a set. The input can be a checkbox the user can check on or off. The checkbox is great for any yes or no options, such as, "Make this my default address." An input element can even be a button, but the recommendation is to use a button element instead. We'll talk about the button element shortly. Notice that none of these controls have any text associated with them, not even the button. So the user has no hint as to what the control is asking for. In many cases, we use labels to provide that text. Let's try out each of these form controls by building the Create My Pet page. Once again, we are in VS Code with the Pet Cafe folder open. We'll start by creating a new web page. Recall how to do that? Open Explorer, hover here next to the folder name, and click the new file icon. We'll name the page pet-create.html. Press Enter to create the file, and I'll click Explorer again to close it. Recall the quickest way to create the basic structure of the page? Yep, we'll use emmet. Type bang or exclamation point and press Tab or Enter. For the title, we'll follow our naming convention and enter Create My Pet, a colon, and our website name, Virtual Pet Cafe. We want all of our pages to have our navigation bar. Click on index.html, copy the header element and all of its nested elements. Click back to pet-create.html and paste them directly under the body element opening tag. We also want all of our pages to have a copyright notice. Again, click on index.html, scroll down, and copy the footer element with its contents. Then back in pet-create.html, paste it just above the body closing tag. For the content of the page, we want a main element with an H1 heading of Create a Custom Virtual Pet. Under the heading, let's add a P element to visually separate the input elements we'll define. Then add an input element and set its type attribute. If the cursor is within the quotes and we press Control Space, VS Code provides us with a list of the valid input types. There are a lot of options. We'll try several of them. For this input element, select text to define a normal text box and set the ID attribute to name. Recall that we need the ID attribute to associate a label with this text box. Then let's add the label. We add the label element within the P element above the input element. We set the for attribute to the ID of the input and set the content to pet's name. Next, let's add a date. Start with a P element. Insert an input element, set its type attribute to date, and its ID attribute to adoption-date. We want the label to appear in front of the date, so we add the label element above the input. Set the for attribute to the ID of the input, and the content to virtual adoption date. To try out a number, again start with a P element. Insert an input element with a type of number and set its ID attribute to age. Add the label above the input, set the for attribute to the ID of the input, and the content to pet's age. Let's do two more: an email address for the owner's email and a checkbox for an add me to your mailing list. Stop the video now if you want to try those on your own. Are you ready to see my result? For the email address, I set the input element to a type of email and set the ID attribute to email. I added the label element above the input, setting the for attribute to the ID of the input and setting the content to owner's email. For the checkbox, I added another input element, set its type attribute to checkbox, and set the ID attribute to mailing-list. This time, I added the label element below the checkbox. That way, the label will appear after the checkbox. I set the for attribute to the ID of the input, which is mailing-list, and the content of the label to add me to your mailing list. Is that close to what you came up with? Cross your fingers and bring up the browser, or click Go Live if you don't have it running. Click Create My Pet, and there's our new page. Here is the input box for the user to enter any text. With the date input box, the user can enter a date, or click the icon to drop down a calendar. The number input only allows entry of numbers. Clicking the arrow spinner increases or decreases the number. We can type anything into the email box, and it doesn't appear to provide any validation. That's because the form controls are only validated when they are within a form and the form is submitted. We'll talk more about forms later in this lesson. And here is our checkbox that the user can check or uncheck. Before we move on, let's try some radio buttons. I'll rearrange the windows. Going back to VS Code, let's define the radio buttons after the pet name here. Since we want the radio buttons to appear as a group, let's add a field set element. A field set tells the browser to draw a box around the enclosed elements. Nested within the field set, we define a legend element to give the group a name. We want the user to select a pet type, dog or cat. So our legend is, what type of pet? After the legend, inside the field set, we add two radio buttons. For the first one, insert the input element, set the type attribute to radio, and the ID attribute to dog. Radio buttons also need the value attribute. The user doesn't enter a value into a radio button. Rather, the radio button automatically assigns a value based on the user's choice. We need to define the value represented by each radio button. For this radio button, we set the value to dog. Add the label after the input so the label appears to the right of the radio button. Set the for attribute to the ID of the input and the label content to dog. Create a similar radio button for a cat. I'll just copy-paste and adjust the IDs and text, changing dog to cat. Looking at the browser, we see the frame with our legend, but we can pick multiple options, so it's not working as it should. That's because even though we are displaying the radio buttons together in a frame, we haven't defined this set of radio buttons as a group. Let's jump back to the editor. To define a radio button group, we add the name attribute to the input element and give each radio button in the group the same name. Let's name this radio button group pet-type. So we add the name attribute to each input element here and here. Looking back at the browser, now when we select a radio button, it automatically deselects the other radio buttons in the group. It's working! We've now seen many of the faces of the input element. Let's go back to the slides. So, we interact with the user with the input element. It is much more powerful and flexible than it may first appear. The input element tells the browser to display a control for user entry or selection. The type attribute defines the type of control we want to display, everything from a basic text box to a date picker to a checkbox or radio buttons. For the full set of input element types, see the MDN documentation. Check out the lesson links at the end of this lesson for a link. The ID attribute provides a unique identifier for each element. The name attribute is used to group elements. It also has a special meaning when used within a form. We'll talk more about that when we talk about forms shortly. And the value attribute is the user entered or selected value. For radio buttons, checkboxes, and select options, it is the value of the control when the button or option is selected. Next, let's look at some of the other interactive elements beyond input.